Welcome to Sociology. Today we're going to be talking about meaning and emotion as causes of social order. Let's begin class with our picture of the puzzle. We have the cause and the effect. Today we're going to focus on the upper left-hand corner of our puzzle and a very specific part of that puzzle. We're going to look at culture and meaning. The week after next, we'll probably look at authority and markets and social structure, all these other causes, but today we're going to only look at culture and meaning. Situational mechanisms link culture and meaning to our internal states. There's four internal states we're going to be looking at this semester: emotion, habit, self-interest, and values. For the moment, for the first half of this lecture, I don't even want you to think about internal states. I really want to focus on culture and how culture, all by itself, sort of regardless of internal states, culture creates social order. Culture does shape every single internal state. Culture shapes habit. Culture shapes self-interest. Culture definitely shapes your values. But for today, the second half of the lecture, we're only going to look at the relationship between culture and emotion. Social order requires shared meanings. Meaning is a shorthand way of saying the ability of people to communicate. Think about it. It's a very, very simple premise. We need to be able to understand each other in order to cooperate and coordinate. Meaning works at many levels. There's macro level meaning. There's the meanings that our federal government creates. There's the meaning that Hollywood creates. There's the meaning that corporations create. There's meso-level meaning. There's the meanings that the state of California and our school system creates. There's meso-level meanings that if you're a member of the Boy Scouts, maybe the Boy Scouts creates a meaning system that's important to you. And then there's our micro-level meaning systems, where it's our small group interaction and the meanings that are sort of present at the micro-level. And again, meaning works through situational mechanisms. If situational mechanisms don't make sense to you by the end of today, situational mechanisms should make a lot of sense. Culture refers to the expressive side of human life. So again, my examples of culture go from sort of the macro all the way to the micro, to the small scale. So we've got beliefs, scientific knowledge of every sort of variety, from biological knowledge to chemistry to sociology and psychology, all of our sort of academic knowledge we're looking at as culture, because they give meaning to our life. They help us express reality. Informal rules, laws, attitudes, popular culture, interpretations, jokes, all of these things help us give meaning to our world. They help us interpret, label, and understand our world. If you think about why a modern American interprets the world the way they do, it's because of their culture. If we go back in time to the 1800s, and if I traveled back in time and I said, oh, well, you know, I was reading this article about subatomic particles on my iPhone, and it wouldn't sync up with the internet. All of these words that I'd be using in the 1800s I'd sound like I was a witch. They wouldn't make sense because our culture has changed dramatically. And think about all the new words that have entered the human language in the last 20 years, from internet to iPhone, modems, and all the words surrounding computers. There's other words like metrosexual, even homosexual. If we went back in the past, people wouldn't know what that word means. So our culture has changed. Our scientific knowledge has evolved. And in all of these ways, we are giving meaning to reality. We are labeling reality. We are understanding reality. And there's a whole host of sort of meaning systems that have evolved, which help us understand our reality and give meaning to it. And that's what we're studying today, is meaning systems. Another way of looking at this is software. If I have the right program, I can do lots of things on my computer, right? Well, what if we think of culture the same way? If I am going to a rodeo, and I don't know how to behave, I don't know what meaning system, I don't know what words they're using at the rodeo, I don't know how to interpret what's going on, because I've never been to a rodeo. I don't have that software. Therefore, if we look at, you know, me as a computer, I don't know how to function the software, my software says do not compute. Now, if I went to an academic convention, I do know how to interpret my surroundings, who is who, I know how to label people, I know how to negotiate that environment, I know how to read those codes, because I have that software. I've been to many academic conferences. So the idea here is that culture helps us code and decode our reality, and it includes the laws that we live with. Our laws tell us how to interpret reality. What's right, what's wrong, what's illegal, what's legal. Popular culture gives us a lot of meanings that we use to interpret reality. If I start talking about Bart Simpson, or I call somebody a Homer Simpson, you know the reference and you understand it, and you can interpret the meaning I'm trying to convey. All of those things are culture. We have an example of shared meaning here. When we have standardized weights and measurements, if I can talk about a gram or an ounce, we all know what a gram or an ounce is if we know about weights and measurements, and it's something that we can sort of, oh, we have a shared meaning about how much a gram or an ounce is. And it sort of lubricates the wheels of social interaction. Same thing with money. If I say, hey, I want to sell you something, and I can tell you it's $10 or $5, you know what $10 and $5 are, you know what that can buy you, therefore I'm communicating value to you, and you understand that. Same thing with time. I find a lot of people think that time has always existed. Human understanding of time, human creation of time, has evolved. We didn't always have this idea of, you know, hours and minutes and seconds. That was something that humans gave meaning to their reality and said, it matters that you come at 9 o'clock or 10 o'clock in the morning to my class. There's a difference between 9 o'clock and 10 o'clock. There are still some cultures today that have these conceptions of time where there's only morning, afternoon, and night. So again, shared meaning facilitates predictability and cooperation. If I want to buy carrots from you, I need to know how many pounds of carrots I'm going to get. If I'm going to buy milk, I want to know whether I get a gallon or whether I get something else. And it's very useful for us to cooperate because I know what I'm getting because I know exactly how much a gallon is. Same thing with money. Money is symbolic. Money is collective. Inherently, money has no value. It's a green piece of paper with some pictures on it. But we agree that money has value. And that's a shared meaning. Money is completely a shared meaning. When you are dealing with adults and you say, I'll see you on Monday at 9 a.m., they know what you're saying, and it's easy to coordinate and cooperate because we have a shared meaning of time. Now, I'm not trying to tell you that culture is only time and money and weights and measurements. Culture includes our scientific knowledge, our popular beliefs, our interpretations, our jokes, even our personal identities. If I say I am a father, you know what that means. That conveys a meaning that you understand. Same thing with informal rules, laws, attitudes. All of these things help us understand ourselves, others, and our environment. So if meaning is very important for social order, if meaning facilitates social order, it helps us cooperate, it helps us coordinate, we have to ask the question, how are meanings created? Well, we have an article that I want you to read. It's called Islands of Meaning. It talks about these islands of meanings. And the way we learn about language and the way we learn about culture is through word association. So I remember when I taught my first child how to speak and how to understand the world. And I would say to him, you know, this is a kitty, this is a cat, it's a pet, they're furry, they're playful, they have whiskers, they have bad breath, they go meow. And my child definitely developed a very good vocabulary. Everyone who met my son would say, wow, he's only a year old and his vocabulary is enormous. If you understand language and language acquisition, you understand that every word has to be understood with reference to another word. I used to do this assignment in class where I would give students this thing called a lychee berry. And many Americans have never eaten a lychee berry. So I'd give it to students in class, and they'd go off and they'd eat the lychee berry. And then I'd say, now I want you to go back into the room and tell your fellow classmates about the experience you just had without using the word lychee berry. And they'd go and they'd talk about, you know, oh, I had a fruit. It was sweet, but sort of sour. And they had to explain their experience to someone who didn't have that experience. So what did they do? they found sort of words that allowed them to convey that meaning. They talked about sweetness and sourness, and they compared it to other fruit. They said it's sort of like a grape, but it's also sort of like a melon. And they sort of were trying to find the words to convey the meaning. So anytime you have a situation like that, you're learning how meaning is created. Same thing with Coca-Cola. We have another example here. When you think of Coca-Cola, what are all the other words that pop into your head? A lot of these words come from the corporation that's trying to put the meanings in your head to get you to associate it with positive things, but there's also other people who are trying to get you to associate Coca-Cola with negative things. So when I think of Coca-Cola, I think sugar, sweet, soda. I also think of Pepsi. I think of burgers, pizza, caffeine, studying, diabetes. The idea here is that we understand symbols like Coca-Cola, sugar, sweet, with reference to other symbols. So I want you to read that article by Evader Zubral and try to understand how meaning is created. The other point is that meaning is created through negation. If I say that poor people are lazy, by implication, by negation, I'm also saying that non-poor people are not lazy. If I say that women are emotional, by negation, by implication, I'm kind of saying that men are not emotional. And built into our meaning systems are these sort of ideas of opposites. So if I say, men are this, I'm usually implying something about women. If I say tall, you think short. And our meaning system is very much set up in terms of oppositions, and it's also set up in terms of associations. So read that article and try to understand where meaning comes from. Culture is socialized, meanings are taught. So you've got parents teaching children, teacher teaching students, peers teaching peers. Republicans will teach other Republicans their meaning system. Democrats will socialize other Democrats to their meaning system. Culture is taught, culture is socialized. We learn it from other people. The last thing I want to say today is that all of this stuff about culture, meaning coming through association, is really cutting-edge research in many, many different fields, not just sociology. If you're studying sort of neural psychology and neurology, we know from biological research that our brains have neural networks. So if I say Coca-Cola, there is a little shock of electricity that goes off in your brain, and these other sort of neural networks get mobilized, and you start interpreting Coca-Cola with the neural networks that have been sort of fused into your brains over and over through advertisement and through sort of just personal experience. You have some meaning system that you use to interpret Coca-Cola, and it's not just at the level of sociology, it's at the level of brain chemistry where your neural networks are sort of shooting off their pistons to interpret that word, Coca-Cola or cat, dog, whatever word I give you. Your brain is shooting off electricity using your previous experience and knowledge to interpret that word. Same thing with cognitive psychology. A lot of cognitive psychologists are studying how we interpret and perceive reality. And a lot of cognitive psychologists are saying if you want to change your life, you have to change the way you interpret reality. Sociology agrees with this position completely. If you want to change the way you think about food, if you want to change the way you think about smoking or change your behavior, you have to change your thinking and your interpretation of reality. The people who do marketing research are very well aware of this, and that's why marketing is very, very effective. Same thing with political research and politics. A lot of politicians know about this stuff. They use focus groups to try out different words and different phrases, and if it creates the desired effect, they use it.